212. Ladies and gentlemen, right now, we want to bring forth to the stage a very special guest, the undisputed.
Nah, son, baby. And this is another episode.
Can't help but swing it, boy. Swing it, brother, swing.
And this is your host. Nah, son, baby.
Here we go.
Microphone check 1212. This is your host, Nasan, baby. And this is another episode of Swingers After Dark. And I'm with my lovely guest, Eboni Amore. And that's Eboni with an I, because I see you. Eboni with an I and not with a Y, you dig? And also Amore, you know, A-M-O-R-E. But her name should be changed to Eboni some more, because she needs to give me some more. Ow. So Eboni Amore. So how's it going? I love the southern belt. You from the south, right? You from down south, right?
I totally am, for sure.
So what part of the south? The dirty, man. What part of the south?
Well, I'm originally from Arkansas, but I'm in Houston, Texas at the moment.
Oh, listen, I've been to Dallas, but I need to go to Houston, because if they're stacked like you, then I need to go ASAP. So speaking of which, Texas... It's like, how y'all dealing with the coronavirus? Because I heard, like, if you were to fly to, like, someone else, you would need to be quarantined for 14 days. What's up with that?
Ooh, well, you know, it's a bunch of hard-headed people around here that don't want to put on a mask. And so it's just not calming down like we needed to.
And Eboni always say, if people don't want to wear a mask, they don't want to wear a condom. Oh, but that's besides the point. The point is, it's like you exemplify the difference between stripping and exotic dancing. It's like I saw your self-indulgence from Punany TV, and it was like, damn. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, Eboni Amore, she's full-figured. You know, she's thick. She's full-figured thick. And she know, when she busted out in a split, I almost came to myself. But, you know, it was like, damn, she is like sex without penetration. That's how her dancing is. So, you know, Google Eboni Amore and you will see all her links, and you'll also see her Vimeo, the video on Vimeo, Self-Indulgence, from Punany TV, and you'll get to see eroticism at its finest. So how did you get into exotic dancing?
Well, honestly, it was something I kind of always wanted to do, quite frankly. Like, I know that there's that movie, The Players Club.
We be coming. Hey, look here, look here. First of all, I want to welcome all y'all broke-ass entrepreneur niggas to the Players Club.
That came out when I was, like, 16, and me and one of my cousins, one of my close cousins, we snuck and watched that movie, and we were just like, look, when we turn 18, we're going to become some dancers, and we're going to go to college, and we're going to move to Atlanta. And so... my cousin just went to college. I ended up going to college and becoming a dancer. So that's kind of how I got into it. I was never really nervous, because I always knew that was something I wanted to do, and I was always really comfortable with my body anyway. So that's originally how I just got into it. I mean, the first thing I did was, because I wasn't old enough to get into the clubs when I turned 18, the first thing I did was do a few private parties, like house parties and bachelor parties, things like that. So until I was old enough to get into an actual club.
So how did you get comfortable to dance in front of people who you don't know, like strange men, like creeps? Like, how did you get that courage? Because also in Players Club, Dominique said that her first... you know, her first time at the Players Club, she felt like shitting bricks. So was it the same feeling? How did you get over stage fright?
Well, like I said, I never really felt afraid. You know, like, I didn't have those same feelings I never felt degraded. I never felt, actually, it was very liberating for me, because it just felt like, you know, I could get on the stage and have control over an entire room. Like, who wouldn't feel powerful in that moment if you actually think about it? You know what I'm saying? So I never had those feelings of, you know, feeling degraded or feeling nervous or scared or anything like that.
So were you always stacked? Because, ladies and gentlemen, you know, listen, I'm not really a breast man, but, you know, I'm a convert to the nation of breastesses. You dig? So it's like, you know, your areolas, it looks like my favorite pancakes. So can you tell the public, like, your bra size so they can get an idea of how stacked you are?
I am 34-0.
Oh, that old means, oh, my lord, that's some big old titty. So 34. You know, 3 plus 4 is 7. So that's like, those titties are like godlike. So, you know, when you add them together and, you know, 34 and, oh, my Lord, listen, it's only fitting. So were you always stacked, like, top? You also bottom heavy, too. But were you always like a brick house? Were you always stacked?
I was, actually. I mean, it's funny because I was honestly a late bloomer. Like, I didn't honestly start getting perks until maybe 15, 16. But since then, like, I just always had boobs. I always had hips. I always had butt. I just always had it.
So were the older guys always try to holler at you? Did they try to holler?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. So
they,
you know, found out how old I was. But, you know.
Oh, they was like, pause, pump the motherfucking brakes. So do you remember your first, first of all, how did you get your first dancing gig? And do you remember that night, that event, or that party?
Well, my first dancing gig was actually a birthday party. And I got that through this guy. Well, actually, it was one of my homegirls that introduced me to this guy because she wanted to get into dancing herself. And she was like, I mean, she needed a partner. And so me, her, and this guy, we all sat down together because we wanted him to kind of be like our manager. And he was the one that actually got us the birthday gig. And so we get there that night. There was one other girl there. And, you know, I felt a bit of nerves, but not so nervous to where I'm like, I'm not going to be able to do this, or I'm scared or whatever. And I kind of just went out there and winged it. Like, and, you know, people loved it. Of course, you know, my manager had some notes. But other than that, I had a great time, made some money, and it was fun.
So how did the fellas treat you during your first party and throughout the years of you dancing?
I'm sorry, say that again for me.
How did the guys treat you your first time dancing and throughout the years of erotic dancing?
Well, I mean, there's mixed reviews, you know. There are guys that are, you know, totally cool with it. They think it's cool, you know, they think it's sexy or whatever. But then you have some guys that are just like, ugh, you a hoe, you're degrading yourself, and how can anybody respect you, and all of this kind of, you know,
the typical bullshit. So what is so liberating and free about exotic dancing?
It's just, like I said, the control that you can have over a room. Like, when you step on the stage, all eyes are on you. You know, if you really just know what you're doing. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, to have people in awe of, you know, just what you're doing is very liberating. To have that attention in that moment is very liberating to me.
And it's crazy because before I inboxed you, I didn't know how you looked. But, you know, you wanted to do the interview right then and there. So I was like, let me Google Miss Amore. And I was like, oh, shit. And then I saw your self-indulgence.
Listen.
I'm thinking about that video. You got me tongue-tied. Ow. So on Punany TV, self-indulging, like your dance solo, I was like, oh, shit. You know, she make a brother want to marry her. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, it was like how you move. It was art. It was an art form. You know, it wasn't sleazy. It was sensual. It was seduction. You know, how you took off your robe, you know, how you move, how you prance like a kitten on a stage. And, you know, it was like your grace, you know. And like I said, you busting in that split. I was like, oh, listen, I had like fantasies, you know what I'm saying, bedroom fantasies. I was like, if she go do a split on a stage, she could do a split somewhere else. But that's besides the point. So, you know, it was like, how did you get in, like, when did you find your stride? Like, when did you become seasoned? Like, when did you find your swag? Like, when were you in your bag as far as erotic dancing?
I will say it was later on, definitely later on, as I started to get into the clubs and I, you know, got a chance to really look around and, you know, how we carry ourselves in the clubs, how we operate, all that kind of stuff, you know what I'm saying? So as I got into the clubs and I was working the club, I, you know, started to really piece myself together, so to speak. So that's more of what it was for me, and that's kind of when I became seasoned and even more confident in my ability.
So have you dated a patron?
Yes.
So, see, I'm glad you said that. Let's rewind. So, like, how, because I'm a firm believer, right? I don't want to stereotype. I don't want to generalize. But I'm a firm believer. It's like, if you go to a strip club, a stripper / exotic dancer, she's going to put you, a man, in one of the two categories, a Mac or a trick. You feel me? Like, as soon as you put out your dollars, you know, she automatically going to put you in a trick bag. But you said you dated one of your patrons or a patron at a club. So how did you distinguish him from the rest of the motherfuckers who you might think is thirsty or it's just a gig, it's just a job? I'm not here to get wiped up. I'm not here to get married. I'm not here to play Ken and Barbie. I just want to get this money. I just want to get this bag and bounce. So how did you, like, how would a guy distinguish himself from the other guys at a party event or at the club? Give the fellas some game. Because, you know, dudes, they come to the strip club, they fall in love. You know what I'm saying? They fall in love. So give the fellas some game about how they could, you know, get in there like swimwear. If they want to, you know, court a woman at the club all the while having her respect towards him.
Well, first of all, what I'll say about myself is I don't not respect anybody that comes to a strip club. Do you understand? Like, the only thing that I don't respect is mistreatment. So if you come into the club and you're having a good time and you're spending money and you may have, it's an ATF, it's called an all-time favorite, which is basically just your favorite girl that you come to see when you come into the club.
Listen, when you're dealing with dope boys and dudes in the street cats, they don't want to hear the acronym ATF because they think it means like alcohol, tobacco, and firearms, you know? Anyway, keep going.
No.
That's what I said. But, I was like, I did the Scooby-Doo on you. I was like, what was that? You know what I'm saying? Anyway, keep going.
Right, no. I definitely will explain it. But, like I said, I don't, you know, I respect everybody that comes into the club as long as they respect me. And I, you know, I'm not just in this for money. Like, money is, of course, a good part of it, but I also am in this because I enjoy it. You know, this is something that I like to do as opposed to, oh, this is just a job for me. Like, it's way more than that for me. You know, it is an artistic outlet for me, so to speak. So, I'll just say that first. As far as trying to date people in the club, no, that's not my main thing thinking about when I go in or anything like that. but I'm also really big on vibes. So, you know, if I'm, you know, sitting with someone and I'm vibing with them or whatever, and, you know, I just happen to get those really good vibes from them, then maybe I want to explore it. Maybe I won't. It just really depends on that. You know, either you have that connection or you don't. Like, there's nothing you can say or do that's going to make you have that connection. It's just there or it's not, you know?
So he needs some finesse.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's not even finesse. It's just either, you know, either the connection is there or it's not.
No. Listen, Miss Amore, I love you. I love you like, you know, Sunday food. But it's all about finesse. He got to fuck your brain first. Come on, stop playing. You gotta fuck your brain. Anyway, but so what do you mean about vibe? Give me an example of how a man could vibe, like hit you. It's like y'all on some, not on some soulmates type shit, but on some, the stars aligned that night. So give us an example, like in that environment. Like how can you connect? How can you connect with an exotic dancer in that environment?
You just gotta be a cool person. Like, you gotta be a cool person. You can't be, you know, for me, it's like, if you're able in that environment to look past the sexual aspect of things, and you're actually wanting to get to know me and talk to me and things like that, like, you're actually interested in, you know, something else other than the tits and the ass in front of you, like, that'll catch my attention. But like I said, again, this is not something that you can't finesse. Like, this is either it's there or it's not. You know what I'm saying?
So, keep going.
Yeah, it's just more of that for me. Like, I don't ever deal with something that's forced. And me, I'm a pretty good judge of character, so I can tell when somebody's trying to force some shit. You know what I'm saying? And that's the turnoff. So, for me, it's either there or it's not, you know?
So, are you currently dancing at a club right now?
I do not. I mostly work online now, and I do featured performances where people pay me to come out and perform. So, no, I'm not actually at a regular club anymore.
Listen, that's good, because if I would have saw you at the club, we would have went to the champagne room, and the dance would have been not on me, but on you. You dig? So, speaking of the websites, how do you feel like, because you actually have a fan base, like I could attest to this, you actually have a fan base on Twitter, you have supporters on Twitter, Instagram, you know, even on your website. So how do you feel like to touch on you saying that you're not doing this for the money, you're not doing this for the bag, you're not doing this for the cheddar cheese? That's just like the cherry on top. It's not the cake. It's not even the fucking frosting. So how do you feel about a lot of chicks, since this pandemic, they having like an OnlyFans page? Because I'm like, yo, a lot of you broads, y'all don't need an OnlyFans page. So you think that they throwing salt in the game? Like how everybody want to, you know, get into the podcast business, but they only got 5 podcasts in 1 year. Like, you know, people want to hop on a wave. So what do you think about this OnlyFans bandwagon?
Well, I mean, again, it's like people hopping on the wave, you know, especially since Beyonce came out and said something about the OnlyFans. Now everybody wants to get on OnlyFans. Like, even celebs say, you would think that they'd be well off of, why would you want to do that? Want to be on OnlyFans. I mean, it's a money thing.
Wait, hold on. Beyonce started that shit?
Beyonce, well, she didn't start it, but when she did it, then you saw an influx of, like, people getting on fans.
So the Beehive did that shit. That's so because of the Beehive, by the way, of Beyonce, not all these regular chicks, these 9-to-5ers, want to be on OnlyFans. Is that what you're telling me?
Yeah, she just, you know, to me, her saying it kind of just made it okay for them. Like, whereas before, they were kind of talking shit about us, like, being on OnlyFans, you know?
See, and your OnlyFans is professional. And once again, Google Eboni Amore. That's EBONIAMORE. Mm-hmm. And it should not be Eboni Amore. It should be Eboni some more, because you got to give me some more, because I want a lot of that Eboni. So it's like it's professional, because a lot of these chicks, they just take clips from their IG and put it on their OnlyFans, or they just do on some rinky-dink fish market shit and just put it on their OnlyFans. So how do you distinguish yourself from the rest of the motherfuckers who want to do the same thing, but you're doing it in a professional way. How do you market yourself as an exotic dancer on Instagram and IG and Twitter?
It's really
Hold on. I fucked up. This tequila is fucking me up. On IG is the same thing as Instagram. Duh. I meant on Instagram, OnlyFans, and Twitter. Anyway, keep going. How to market yourself? How did you market yourself? Give these chicks some game.
Well, it's really just about, you know, being consistent with marketing. With me, I don't do that whole blast marketing where you're just blasting like 3 or 4 times a day. Hey, check me out. You know what I'm saying? I, you know, drop a little fire clip or a little fire picture maybe once every 2 days and say, hey, check me out. And that gets more attention because people are looking for you at that point. You know, there's a want. They're searching for you at that point. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, you just have to really make sure that you're putting out some quality work when you do have people come and subscribe to you, you know? So that's really all it is for me, and that's what's been working for me, you know?
In other words, they got to be presentable before it's acceptable. You know, you can't serve filet mignon on top of a fucking trash can. Like, you know what I'm saying? And it's professional. It's crazy because, you know, you're doing your thing. And when did you get that feeling like, damn, like people really fuck with me? Like when I get book sales, like when I find out somebody buying my shit, when they tell me I bought your book, I still get butterflies. And I've been in the book industry since 2009. So when was that moment when you first started, you know, promoting yourself, marketing yourself, and putting yourself out there on social media where you said, damn, people really fuck with me? Like, when did you get that moment? Because you're really putting yourself out there to get scrutinized and criticized. But when was that eureka moment when you knew that you had something like, yo, damn, I got something? Mm-hmm. Because no matter how pretty, beautiful, or handsome, or attractive, or sexy we may think we are, we still need that validation and verification from other people. You know, like, it's easy for people who I know say that my book is the shit. But when a stranger comes along and say, listen, your book changed my life, it's like, damn. So when did you get that moment? Because you have a lot of fans and followers on your sites.
Well, I would think that moment came probably last year, because honestly, I've been on OnlyFans since like 2018.
Now, in other words, ladies and gentlemen, she's not on the dig. She's not on the bandwagon. Keep going.
Yeah. So I think that moment came when I got on there and I was really promoting myself, and my subscribers started to go up. And I noticed that you have some months that are better than others. You have people that are subscribed for just 1 month, or you'll have people that will stay with you. Well, I discovered last year that I had what I call as my core 500. So there's a core 500 subscribers that have been subscribed to me from the very beginning. And a lot of them actually come to me and tell me things like, you know, I've been following your career since you were in Smooth magazine, and I remember when you were in King. And
You were in Smooth and King?
I was.
Oh shit, we gotta talk about that. Anyway, keep going.
But yeah, so they'll come to me and say things like that, and they subscribe to me, and they're buying my videos, and they're buying my pictures, and all of that kind of stuff. And you know, a lot of people did not think that I would be very successful with this because, you know, I don't actually have sex on my page. Like, the most I may do is, you know, I may, you know, do a little masturbation or anything like that, but I don't actually have sex with another person on my page.
Listen, I'm getting that masturbation page on the free, on the slick, on the cool. But anyway, that's why, see, women like you are like Cleopatra. You feel me? Because Cleopatra seduced men not because of her sex game. She didn't use her pussy to seduce men. It was her aura. You know, it was her charisma. Mm-hmm. It was her personality. It was her whole, as you say, vibe. And, you know, a lot of chicks nowadays, they don't have to bust it open to get money. They could just seduce. Listen, I know chicks who make money just from talking. Mm-hmm. You feel me? So you don't have to be a flatback chick to get money. You could use finesse like you're doing. You're using your sexuality and your liberation as your freedom to feed the fantasies of dudes and chicks who find you appealing. So do you think that the internet is a game changer? Like, instead of you doing porn, to, you know, you could be an entrepreneur and just pose like an exotic model.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I think that, you know, porn stars, like anybody in the sex industry, first of all, I have a lot of respect for, even though porn is not really my bag, like, I have a lot of respect for porn stars.
So, wait, so you're telling me you never wanted to get into porn, or anybody asked you to get into porn? Because when I saw your self-indulgence, I was looking on X videos and Pornhub to see if you had videos. You know what I'm saying? So, would you get into porn, or why wouldn't you get into porn?
Well, again, that's really just not my bag. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, I know what type of sex I enjoy, and I know that, you know, I know the power that sex has. And so I don't feel like that's something I want to put on camera or even have with somebody I really don't know at this stage in my life, you know. So that's why it's really not my bag. Like I say, all power to people who, you know, do it for sure, because I'm damn sure looking. I indulge in porn myself. I like looking at it, but it's just not my thing.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know, don't be surprised to see your fearless podcaster/author, not Son the Great, and X Videos or Pornhub Productions with Eboni Amore, because she's talking that shit now until she comes across a motherfucking like me who would make her do something that she never thought that she would have done before. So have dudes approach you to do like XXX videos?
Oh yeah. Even in the like professional porn stars have come to me and be like, hey, do you like you'd want to do this? And I'm like, you know, no, it's not really my thing. It's not
bad. Come on. See, you bullshit me more. I got to get at you. You're telling me that you never even wanted to get an X videos. Like, what about if it's a porn star who tickles your fancy that you thought about fucking on camera? Would you do it?
No, that's not my thing. That's not my thing.
See, that's why I fucks with you, because a lot of these chicks, they don't need to be in porn because they don't know how to perform. You know, it's like mm-hmm. they're just sitting there like, it's like, listen, perform, like do some splits. Like, that's why, like, when I saw your video, your dance solo, self-indulgence, like, I saw one of the comments and dudes busted a nut. One of the dudes said he busted a nut just from you dancing. So why the fuck that you got to do porn when you have dudes jacking off, masturbating, beating their knee just from you dancing? And it was seductive. Mm-hmm. It was seductive, like, by the way you know, like you have a nice shape. Like, your shape, like, you have a nice shape. And this was before I inboxed you. So... Mm-hmm. I had to remind myself, you know, I had to like cool down, like, you're doing your thing. But that's besides the point. So tell us about like King and Smooth magazine, because I remember when I was in college, I wanted to do like my version of King and Smooth magazine. And this was before they came out and they just beat mm-hmm. me to the punch. So I wanted to do something like King and Smooth magazine. I just didn't have the finances because I was a broke college student, but it was good to see somebody else do it. So, you know, when the only Smooth magazine that I cop was Takara, and you remind me of Takara. Like, I used to have like an ill crush on Takara because she has some tiggle bitties just like you. So how did you get into Smooth and King magazine?
Well, first of all, again, that was something I always wanted to do. And I was just like, I'm gonna get there one day. And so, back in like 2007 is when I did it. And I was really young. I met somebody that again became my manager, and I ended up going to New York and living for like a year and a half. While I was up there, I think probably 3 months after, like while I was up there, after 3 months of me being up there, should I say, I ended up getting a meeting with the editor from Smooth, and she was just like, oh yeah, we need to use you, you know, like, she actually ended up giving me a 6-page spread, my first shoot, so I was excited.
So what's the difference between King and Smooth? How did you get to Smooth? I mean, excuse me, how did you get to King?
Well, King, I actually got that shoot being at one of their parties and, you know, just really talking to the editors there. They were like, hey, you know, we saw you in Smooth, you know. And I was like, yeah, you know, that was me. You know, I model a little bit or whatever. And, you know, they were like, okay, well, you know, we got King Magazine. Hey, you know, you want to do this? And that's how that happened.
So do you get a lot of dudes, like, in your inbox talking about, yo, I know you get dick pics galore and you have perverts and creeps, but do you have dudes talking about, you know, I'll do this for you, I want to be your sugar daddy, and I want to marry you, especially foreign motherfuckers, like, overseas, like, they the biggest tricks. But do you have dudes, like, giving you propositions all the time?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. All day long.
So how would a non-tricking motherfucker like me shoot his shot? Like, if I see you on the street, or even at a party, like, at a King, like, at an industry party, like, how would you want a man to shoot his shot without breaking? He's like Jordan, the game-winning shot against the Cavaliers in the face of Craig Elo. How would a man get his Michael Jordan on and score?
You have to just be very, like, respectful. Like, you got to be just real chill and just really respectful. You know what I'm saying? Like, first of all, if you come at me any way sexually, that's an automatic turn off. Like, I want to know that you're interested in more than that, you know, because I have so many people coming at me at a sexual nature all the time that you gonna just have to come with the gift, you know, that I haven't heard.
And I tell these dudes on my podcast, I said, fellas, women, they get sexually advances, you know, they get sexual advances all the damn time. And you should not lead with your dick. Don't lead with your waist. Lead with your face. You know, come different. Like, she hear the sex talk all the time. And if she likes you, she's going to give you the pussy anyway. Or she's going to fuck with you anyway. She's going to date you anyway. So why are you talking about sex? Just get in her head, because you may not want to deal with shorty. She may be a fucking nutcase. You know, so you have to see where her head is at to see if she could even come in your circumference, correct? Like,
right.
Excuse me?
No, you're absolutely right.
Like it's kind of like if I was a, you know, not if, but, you know, when I become a multimillionaire, it's like a trick. She just talking about my fucking money. It's like, yeah, I love your car. I love your watch. Oh, you live on a house on the hills. And it's like, yo, are you fucking me or are you fucking my prized possessions? You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, it's like, how's your dating life?
Well, at the moment, you know, I am single. At this moment, I enjoy being single.
You should never say that, because your inbox is going to be flooded. Anyway, keep going. So you should have said, I'm married. I'm married with being single. Keep going.
Shoot, they don't even care about that no more.
Yeah, that is true. Anyway, you single, and, like, come on, but every single chick, they got to do, you know, hitting them skins, hitting them draws. So do you have, like a dick in a jar? Like, not dick in a jar. Do you have, like, an emergency, in case of emergency? Like, do you have, like,
a
water hose?
Yeah, in case of emergency, yeah, it's in my drawer, actually. So that's what I told you.
We playing games. So when the last time you seriously dated, huh? What'd you say, babe?
I said, yeah, no, that's in my drawer. I'm sorry.
When the last time you seriously dated somebody?
I seriously dated somebody. Well, I actually had just ended like a long-term relationship last year. So that's also a big part of me, you know, trying to be single and really just focus on myself. So...
Do you have any kids?
I do have a child. I have one boy.
Okay. See, you know, how old is he?
He's 10.
See, fellas, you know. Listen, children, the kids are the best part of a relationship. And, you know, he's at that stage, you know. He may want somebody to, you know, play basketball with him, teach him how to fight, teach him how to put on a tie, teach him, like, the birds and the bees, how to put on a condom, how to catch a fucking football, how to shoot a basketball. So if you shoot your shot, you better be a family man. You dig? You know? But, you know, mm-hmm. What you say?
I say, yes, indeed.
Nah, you got to say it loud for the people in the cheap seats, people in the back row. Say that again.
I said, yes, indeed.
Yes, listen, it's a package deal. You feel me? It's the platinum package, not the bronze, not the gold, not the silver. It's the platinum. You feel me? But so tell us about you giving advice to couples. Like, what is, like, how do you get advice to couples? Do you have like a advice column? Like, break that down.
Well, really the only place I'm getting to do it in is the Punany Poets show. So what happens is during that show, we have a question and answer segment that we do. And I'm not actually a head doctor, but I do have the title as the head nurse.
Wait. So what is the difference between a head doctor and a head nurse? Because I know what a head doctor is, but what is a head nurse?
Well, the head nurse, basically, like I said, it's just a character that was created for me in the show. The head doctor is actually Jessica Holter, which is she's the director of the show, you know. So that's really all that is. And I got that title because, like I said, during these question and answer series, I would have couples or even single people that during that segment that would ask me questions specifically, like about, you know, sex, about intimacy, about, you know, sexuality, things like that, and they'd want to know my opinion. It really is just based on, you know, my opinion and my experience, and I would give that. And then, you know, I would get emails, or Jessica Holter would get emails from the people that were asking me questions saying, hey, you know, what she said, it really helped me, you know? So that's really what that is.
So how did you link up with the Punany Poets?
Oh, God, like, they've been on HBO, Real Sex, that show from back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
And I caught them on air, like, back when I wasn't old enough to dance. And I said I was going to work with them, too. And, you know, over the years, I started to get, you know, come across some of the poets and some of the people that were in the show until I eventually came across Jessica Holter herself. And I was just like, please use me. Like, I really want to work with you. I enjoy your project. I like what you guys are doing. And she was like, okay, you know, send me over, you know, a tape of you dancing. And so I sent her a video of me dancing, and the rest was history from there.
Well, she most definitely did a good job with picking you. And, you know, like I said earlier, not only you exemplify the difference between stripping and exotic dancing, but you also the prime example of putting your thoughts into existence. You're manifesting your thoughts. You say, yo, I see that. I want that. I'm going to get it. You feel me? So
right.
you're the captain of your ship. You're the master of your destiny. You understand me? So listen, if anything, that's a trait that I love in a woman. Like the looks, that's, you know, that's part of the package deal. But a woman like you, you could easily, you know, motivate and inspire your mate, inspire your significant other, because you like, yo, babe, you know, I said I wanted to be on Smooth, got it. Yo, babe, I said I wanted to be on King, got it. Yo, babe, I said I wanted to be on Punany Poets before I was even old enough to know my pussy from a hole in the wall. I got it. And you did.
Uh-huh.
And you did it. So what other projects that you have, Miss Eboni Amore? And ladies and gentlemen, that's Eboni Eboni Amore, Amore. And like I said before, it should not be Eboni Amore. It should be Eboni some more, because I want some more of that yin-yang. So what else do you have down the pike? What projects?
Well, at the moment, I am currently in school for sexology, because I felt like, you know, with me doing those question and answer segments, I should probably put a little education behind my thoughts and my experience And I really felt like that would be beneficial to the advice that I would give out and to that show. So I'm currently getting my sexology certificate so that I can do that.
Okay, so where can people find you? Like, listen, promote yourself, ride your wave, mm-hmm. ride your own clit. This is the shit-talking moment, part, rather, of the episode. So what can we find you? That all this sex, and ladies and gentlemen, once again, as you know me, you know, I don't gas females. But, mm-hmm. you know, I'm going to be Saudi Arabia in this bitch and give Eboni Amore all the motherfucking gas because she deserves to drive to her destiny where she wants to go through her journey. So break down all your websites.
Okay, well, we'll start with the basic one first. So Facebook, I'm Eboni Amore on Facebook. It won't be hard to find me there. Just type in Eboni Amore, E-B-O-N-I-A-F-O-R-E. On Instagram, again, I'm Amore Black, Amore.Black. So Amore.Black19. That is my main page on Instagram. On Twitter, Amore Eboni. They put me backwards. I don't know why they did that. But Amore Eboni, so AmoreEboni on Twitter. On OnlyFans, I'm Miss Amore, the number 4 and the letter U. So MSAMORE, number 4, letter U. I'm also on a website called Sex Panther. And
Sex
that's basically
Panther. That's ladies and gentlemen, that's Sex Panther, like Black Panther, but sex in front of the panther. Keep going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Sex Panther is basically a website where, you know, we can talk dirty on the phone. We can, you know, text dirty. I can send you some nice little pictures and all of that kind of stuff. And again, I'm Eboni Amore on there as well. So if you want to talk nasty to me, you can go on that website and we can do so. But those are all on my website.
Listen, my son, he gets that on the cheap, on the free. Listen, it's not even cheap and free. It's priceless because we make magic. So speaking of Eboni, do you like a touch of ivory for my Caucasian listeners out there? It's like, do you like the, you know, in a mortal word, is a big pun. I don't discriminate. I regulate any shade of that ass. And, you know, a lot of white dudes, they love titties. They love knockers, as they call them, you know. So do you have like a lot of Caucasian fans, supporters?
Oh, absolutely. And I love them. Like I said, I don't discriminate. So I love them. They're actually a lot of fun.
So for all my white cats out there, for all my white studs, you know, if you may, you know, shoot your shot too. She may want a little bit of swirl and her chocolate. You did? She made a little bit of vanilla and her, you know, and her swirl. You know, you feel me? You never know. You know, listen, it doesn't even matter at the end of the day. Sex has no limitations. Ain't that right, baby?
That's right.
And on that note, this has been another episode of Swing is After Dark. And this is your host, Nasun, baby. Check out my website at www.nasunblaze.com. That's www.nashunblaze.com. And check out my ebook, You, Me, Us, Them. The Swinger Manifesto is on Nook, Kindle, iBooks, Google Play. Go get it. It make you say, ow. And shoot me an email at swingpodcast@gmail.com. That's swingpodcast@gmail.com. And hit me up with any questions and all concerns that you may have. Rate, share, subscribe, and comment on this podcast. You dig? And on that note, until next time, peace. And once again, it should not be Eboni Amore. It should be Eboni, give me some more, you dig? Ow.